हेलो फ्रेंड्स, वेरी गुड इवनिंग टू ऑल ऑफ यू एंड आई विश एवरीवन इज डूइंग वेल एंड कीपिंग सेफ एंड हेल्दी। आई वुड लाइक टू थैंक्स सीए सुमित जी, सीए सचिन जी एंड टीम कासा टू मेकिंग अपॉन ह्यूज रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी ऑफ आर्किटेक्टिंग दिस सीरीज ऑन इंटरनेशनल टैक्सेशन। वी हैव सीन सो फार अ वेरी गुड रिस्पॉन्स ऑन दिस एंड वी आर लुकिंग फॉरवर्ड फॉर मोर ऑफ सच सेशन इन फ्यूचर। Team CASA has always been a torch bearer in terms of sharing knowledge and accredited with around 350 webinars since past few months or we can say since the last lockdown has started. As a student of law, I feel very fortunate to welcome today's speaker, Geetika Gupta ji. To brief about, she has over 17 years of experience in handling direct tax matters. Her experience includes advising large Indian multinational corporate houses on variety of tax matters, including international tax matters, tax due diligence, inbound and outbound investment matters. She has been associated with Big Four for nearly four long period of time. So in the first, this five series, the first session we have been dedicated towards the residency provisions, wherein Mr. Naman Shrimal has enlightened us with the provisions of residency and the taxation arising thereon. The second session was focusing on focus of the Section 9 and the income source rule taxation. We were also enlightened with the provisions of the permanent establishment and recent changes like significant economic presence. In the third session, speaker enlightened with the substantive provisions of Chapter 9 of the Income Tax Act and how the treaty between the interplay and the provisions of DTAA and the Income Tax Act works together. The speaker has also enlightened with the provisions and the taxation in the cases of countries with which India do not have DTAAs. In the fourth session, again an important topic of Section 195 and TDS deduction in case of non-resident payee was discussed. In the learned speaker also discussed the legal and technical intricacies involved and procedural aspects involved in the while issuance of Form 15 CACB and respective rules and the provisions of that. Friends, today is the last day of this webinar and we shall be learning the hottest topic in the international tax as of now, that is the digital taxation. While on daily basis there is development on international and domestic level, few to be named here, the consensus on Pillar 1 and Pillar 2, the UN proposal by Article 12B, US imposing tariff on countries who have applied unilateral measures, and lastly, the agreement on new proposal by G7 countries. Today's session has been divided in four parts by the speaker. The first part will be taking through the digital economy and BEPS recommendations, the genesis of action plan. The part two will be the equalization levy, which is the law of the land and which has been a part of brainstorming for the tax fraternity, tax advisors and fraternity for a longer period of time, at least for a couple of months. Since it has already been implemented, now it has always been part of long drawn controversy and subject to various interpretations. Part three is, as we are aware, that host of changes has been made in TDS and TCS provision with respect to non-resident e-commerce operators. So, learned speaker will be touching upon the subject and the TDS provision in relation to e-commerce operator. And in the final session, we will be moving towards Q&A session, wherein the participant can ask the queries from the speaker. And we shall be happy to take the forward session after that. Now I would like to move the mic to Sumit ji, and who will and request him to formally give a brief introduction about the CASA and our learning platform, and then invite today's speaker Geetika ji to start her deliberation. Over to you, Sumit ji. Thank you.
Thank you, Amit ji. Wonderful introduction about today's program and guest speaker, CA Geetika Balaji. First of all, ma'am, warm thank you for your gracious presence and giving time for this webinar. So once again, welcome to you. And thank you to each participant for joining, wonderfully attending these sessions, and today is the fifth session, and we are going to complete this 5-day study with the help of eminent expert all around in the region. So thank you very much, and any suggestion, any feedback if you have on the subject or any other topic you want to organize me more discussion, so I will definitely in the future, as we are also organizing every Thursday 4 p.m. GST query session, GST dialogue, where only queries will be addressed. Next week, one of the important topic, NPO, where many changes are happening. So charitable institution, what are the tax implications, exemptions? We are organizing exclusive course on this NPO for 5 days, once again. And thereafter, many suggestions are there on other topics, like Manminder ji saying upcoming session on India. Definitely we will plan in future. Already we have planned India's series, you can watch in on our Team Kasa YouTube channel, and in future also we will organize sessions. So with this, I once again welcome to each participant, and you all have my number. Any suggestion, any discussion relating to professional knowledge subject or about the institute, you can contact me anytime. Now I straight away request Geetika ji to take up the technical session. Move forward. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you so much, ji. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Trust all of you and your family members are staying safe. I would like to thank Sumit ji, Sachin ji, Amit ji, and the entire CASA team who has given me the opportunity to present this topic before you. And let's try to make this session an interactive session. And with this, I will move to the topic of today.
Thank you, ma'am.
I can present my screen, Sumit ji.
Not shared by you. Aapne abhi share nahi kiya.
Actually, it is showing the host disabled attendee screen sharing. I'm not able to share.
Just a minute.
Yeah.
You are co-host, you can share. Kya problem dikha raha hai madam?
It is saying host disabled attendee screen sharing.
Ek second. Now please see. Just.
Yes, now I am able to. Yes.
Okay.
Yes, now I am able to. Thank you.
There is some issue in the voice.
Sumit ji,
there is some issue in the voice.
Yes, right? Yes, ma'am. Geetika ma'am, some problem in voice and some.
So hello, can, is it? Is it better now?
No, ma'am. Can you try with without micro without headphone?
Sure.
Hello.
Ji ma'am.
Is it better?
Yes, ma'am. Perfect.
Ma'am. Okay.
Now
okay.
Perfect.
Okay. Just a second.
Earlier there was voice cracking. Now no, perfect.
No, sure. So I'll just share my screen.
Ma'am, without headphone, your voice is perfect.
Okay.
Please don't mute.
Just give me a second. That's fine.
Madam, fine. You can without mic, आप बोलिए.
Okay.
Without headphone.
Is it better?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, sure. Okay, so today I will be taking the topic taxation of e-commerce companies, and we would be covering two topics in this. One is equalization levy, and the second is tax withholding by e-commerce operators. So as Amitji and Sumitji had laid down the agenda, we will be talking about four things. First is digital economy and BEPS, Genesis and Action Plan 1. Then we would be talking about equalization levy, tax withholding by e-commerce operators, followed by Q&A session. So, you know, before discussing about this direct moving to equalization levy, let's try to understand about this digital economy. You would have heard the buzzword digitization, digital economy, e-commerce, and in fact, digital economy being talked as the new economy these days. So why it is so important, you know, various countries, they are coming with the digitization tax, the digital tax on various goods and services. Let's try to understand the background of this. Over the last decade, information technology has gone through an exponential expansion phase in India and globally. This has led to an increase in the supply and procurement of digital services. Consequently, you know, this has led to various new business models where there is a heavy communication networks. So, you know, we talk of something today about digital economy, e-commerce, which is the buying and selling of the goods, provision of services, all through an electronic mode, all through, you know, it is digitization, not requiring human interface. Let us think of a few examples. Today, we have to book a ticket, rail ticket, air ticket. We just log into the website, book the tickets. You know, let's take example of the daily things. We want to order vegetables, any grocery. Just what comes to mind is Grofers, Big Basket. We want to buy any product. What comes to mind? Amazon, Flipkart, Myntra, Jabong. So all these websites. So, you know, it is all digitization. Payments to be made. Paytm, all these things, what comes to this is all digitization. So, you know, in the last few years, this digital e-commerce has been set up, has seen a steep rise at a very rapid pace. In this e-commerce model, many companies providing services or facilitating the supply of goods to the citizens of a particular country may not have any physical nexus in that country. Digital models have the capacity of providing these services online from any remote location, leading to complexity in taxing their revenue. What used to happen under the traditional business model? There is a foreign company, let's say, how it is getting taxed in India. The foreign company will either have, you know, a PE in India by virtue of which it will be taxable. Or if there is no PE, the taxation of a foreign company can be by virtue of some source rules income arising, let's say some royalty, some fee for technical service, interest, dividends, income, etc. arising from India. But just think about this new business models, you know, doing business without any physical presence in the country. They're just sitting outside. They do not require any office in India. They are earning huge profits, but there is no taxation. So e-commerce operators deriving the income from users located in different jurisdictions without physical presence are not getting taxed. So that is the need for having a digital taxation. Uniqueness of digital e-commerce model makes it impossible to tax them under the traditional rules of the PE. As a consequence, these online operations in digital form does not get taxed, which is known to be erosion of the tax base. So government all over the world are grappling with the tax issues raised by these e-commerce companies, primarily due to lack of understanding of the complex communication models, technologies, complex nature of the business, which is affected through internet business, modus operandi of internet business. So what has happened over the years, the business models have evolved, but not the tax technology, not the taxing methods of that. So under the changed circumstances, the traditional concepts of PE and the taxing rules are just not sufficient to tax the cross-border transactions. So, you know, what it looks like to me is what is required and what is happening is the renovation of the international tax rules. You know, I just can equate this to an example. You know, there is a house, there is the house gets old, it gets deteriorated. What comes to our mind? There has to be a renovation of the house. You need to get, you know, various things placed, otherwise you will see the pipe get start leaking. Similarly, there is a renovation of the international tax rules, which is required in these times. And when the renovation is there, even in terms of the tax rule, there is certain expectation. What is being expected? You get a kitchen renovated, there's expectation. I want a modular kitchen. So again, from the renovation of the international tax rule, what is expected is that the profits will be reported where the economic activities that generate them are carried out and where value is created. So this is very, very important. Now, you know, what is boxes on the screen? It basically shows us how has the journey been with regards to the international tax. So the first box, which is towards the left side, is 2015 Action Plan 1, addressing the tax challenges of the digital economy by OECD. The OECD identified the tax challenges which are arising out of the digital economy. And the report highlighted the typical direct tax issues relating to e-commerce, which is difficulty in taxation because there is difficulty in characterizing the nature of the payments, creating a nexus or link between the activity and the taxing jurisdiction, identifying the taxpayer for tax purposes. So what OECD in its draft report did, it suggested various methods to overcome this digital taxation. It suggested there could be a significant economic presence rule. That is, if a particular foreign entity is present in a jurisdiction and it satisfies certain thresholds in terms of users, maybe it will be set to be taxed depending upon the rules framed. It also gave a second option, which was in terms of withholding tax. So withholding tax, like all different kind of payments, what we see under Section 195, Indian residents making payment to non-residents, they have to deduct tax. So similarly, it was suggested the withholding tax provisions could be introduced, wherein the Indian residents, let's say, because we are talking about India jurisdiction, while making payments to the non-residents will be liable to deduct the tax. But there were own challenges of these things, you know, because even if a withholding tax is introduced in the domestic tax law, still there will be no taxation because of the treaties. The treaties will override the act to the extent they are more beneficial. So this was not given weightage by many countries. And then the third point which was suggested, or the third option which was suggested by OECD, was equalization levy. And equalization levy is one which has been adopted by India and which we will be talking today in detail in our ensuing slides. So after this OECD, you know, recognizing the significance of issues relating to e-commerce, the CBDT constituted a committee on taxation of e-commerce for detailing the business models for e-commerce, the direct tax issues in regard to e-commerce transactions, and suggest an approach in this regard. So the e-commerce committee, in its report in February 2016, came out and suggested that equalization levy may be imposed on the digital transactions. And based on the recommendations of the e-commerce committee, the government introduced equalization levy provisions under Chapter 8 of the Finance Act. So these provisions, they were not made a part of the Income Tax Act. They have been introduced by way of Finance Act. The reason is the same what we talked about. If they are part of income tax, they will not get taxed actually because of the treaties. So in 2016, equalization levy provisions came on very limited transactions, which was known as specified services, that is online advertisement, etc. Then, you know, 4 years, these provisions were there in its limited form. However, in 2020, the scope of the equalization levy has been widened a lot. And in fact, last year when these provisions came, it was a surprise because in the finance bill, there was no discussion on the same. It was only at the time of passing of the final provisions that Equalization Levy Act was inserted. And further, these provisions have been broadened by Finance Act 2021. So in today's discussion, we will just touch upon Finance Act 2016 very lightly, and we will be majorly focusing on equalization levy provisions of 2020 as and also as amended by 2021. In fact, in between, by Finance Act 2018, even the significant economic presence, SEP rules, SEP was also introduced in India, and the rules in this regard were recently introduced. Though, you know, because they are a part of the Income Tax Act, they will not have much relevance specifically where the treaty countries are there. Now I will move to equalization levy provisions. Just first of all, I'll brief. Just a minute, I'll just put it here. Okay. So first on the equalization levy provisions, a glimpse of what 2016 provisions provided for, that is EL is taxable at the rate of 6% on the consideration which is received by a non-resident from the residence or from a non-resident having a P in respect of specified services. And the specified services are defined to be online advertisement or any online provision for digital advertising space, any other facility. So these provisions basically provided the charge was like on the resident who had to deposit the tax. And there were certain exceptions to this, that if the non-resident has a PE in India and such income is effectively connected to the PE, then there is no equalization levy. And if the income does not exceed 1 lakh rupees again from per pair basis, there is no equalization levy. And it was on B2B transactions, not on B2C. So this is just a glimpse of 2016 provisions. With this, we will move to 2020 provisions, which are much talked about, a lot of discussions on these digital taxes, a lot of hue and cry. So I'll just brief what the provision states. We'll go slowly here because these are little complex provisions. So what the provisions 2020 state is that equalization levy will be chargeable at the rate of 2% of the amount of consideration received or receivable by an e-commerce operator from e-commerce supply or services made or provided or facilitated by it to specified persons. So I'll just simplify this because it's a long sentence, pretty complicated. So who is affected? Who is liable to pay equalization levy? One who's liable and who is getting captured under this equalization levy provisions? So the person should satisfy the definition of the term e-commerce operator. And the person has to be a non-resident. So the first box, which is this box that says non-resident e-commerce operator, again, the person, the e-commerce operator should own, operate, or manage digital or electronic facility or platform for online sale of goods or provision of services. Friends, we have to be mindful that what the words used are for online sale of goods or provision of services. And the term online has been defined to mean a facility or service or right or benefit or access that is obtained through the internet or any other form of digital or telecommunication network. So the definition of online is very, very wide here. And then it says, what is getting captured under these equalization levy provisions? This is the second box, that is e-commerce supply or services. So first is where an e-commerce operator makes an online sale of goods owned by the e-commerce operator, then the charge will be there. Or there is an online provision of services provided by e-commerce operator. Third is online sale of goods or provision of services or both facilitated by the e-commerce operator or any combination of the above activities. I will maybe take a 1 minute or 30 seconds pause here so that everybody is able to digest the provisions, and in the ensuing slides, we will be discussing this with the help of case studies. Yeah, I'll just take a pause and I'll just put my charger on. And then what it says is the e-commerce supply or services has to be made to whom? It has to be made to a specified person. That is a person resident in India or to a non-resident in certain specified cases, which has been defined as a non-resident if it is made to a non-resident for sale of advertisement targeted at a customer resident in India or for sale of data collected from a person resident in India. So broadly, if the services are rendered to a resident person in India or it is rendered to a non-resident in the specified circumstances, and third category, where the services are provided to a person who buys such goods or services or both using an internet protocol address in India. Any questions here or anybody wants to ask? Because, you know, then in the next slide, we will be moving to some case studies. And again, this will, you know, all these provisions will be relevant, which we will be discussing there.
No, ma'am, as of now, there is no question.
Okay, sure. And, you know, these e-commerce, again, equalization levy, there, the what we discussed was by Finance Act 2020. There are certain...
Here is one question that participant wants to know, how non-resident use IP address in India?
Okay, so I'll just clarify. See, here the non-residents, how they use IP address in India. Let's say there is a person who's a non-resident. The person is traveling to India, right? The person, let's say, stays in Oberoi Hotel. He uses an internet address of the hotel, which is an internet protocol address from India. And he books a ticket. Let's say he has to travel to an in Bombay, from Delhi to Bombay or anywhere. And the ticket is booked on the website of the foreign e-commerce operator. So even though the person is a non-resident, he may be using an internet protocol address in India in such a case. And therein equalization provisions may be applicable.
Yes. Yes, ma'am, it's okay.
Sure. And you know, when these provisions came, there had been a lot of discussions that what sort of companies will get captured? Is it, you know, just made for companies, what we talk like pure e-commerce operators like Amazon of the world, is it? Or let's say many companies will get captured in it. Simply, a manufacturing concern is there. It is, let's say, selling some goods to the Indian parties through its website, whether that will also get captured. Or even these circumstances, let's say a foreign company provides some services or supplies some goods to its subsidiary in India, whether those transactions will also get captured. And these days we see, you know, when there are transactions between holding company subsidiaries, the subsidiaries may be purchasing certain, let's say, raw materials, certain goods from its overseas companies. And either, you know, it is through all online portals or through the ERP systems, etc., this is being purchased. So question arises whether all those companies get captured under equalization levy. So we will be covering various case studies in the ensuing slides. And you know, in Finance Act 2020, when these provisions were inserted, new law, no guidance and no obviously judicial precedents on the same. Different companies taking different interpretations, and obviously you will appreciate even different consultants are having different views on the same. Though the intention, if we see, of the government is to cover a host of transactions under the same, but again, then when we read the law and go as per the technical provisions, the question arises, and it is for the interpretation whether the case really falls under equalization levy provisions or not. So this, after, you know, a lot of discussions were there in 2020, so certain amendments have been made in 2021. The scope of the online sale of goods, so this has been widened. The second box, you know, where it is defined, what is e-commerce supply or services, which was defined in section 164, clause CB of the Equalization Levy Act. This has been amended by Finance Act 2021. And in fact, this stock definition that any consideration receivable, which is there in 165A, which is the charging section, has also been widened by Finance Act 2021, which we will discuss in the next slide. So what has been expended by 2021 is that for the online sale of goods or online provision of services, these five items will be construed as it is online if it is being met. So what it says is, even if there is an online acceptance of offer for sale, even if there is an online acceptance of purchase order, it will be said that this is an online sale of goods or services. Similarly, online placing of purchase order, merely purchasing of place order will also, they said, is includes even, you know, qualifying to be online sale of goods. Similarly, online payment of consideration and the supply of goods or provision of services, whether wholly or partly. And then on the right side of the box, which is 165A subsection 3, again sub clause B, which we were discussing, it says consideration received from e-commerce supply or services shall include consideration for the sale of goods, irrespective of whether the e-commerce operator owns the goods or not. There has been a relaxation which has been provided by the Finance Act 2021 to this extent is in respect of the residence or where the foreign company has a PE in India. So where the non-resident e-commerce operator, let's say, is providing certain services or it is facilitating the services of an Indian person, and that Indian party whose services is being facilitated is resident, then no equalization levy. This exception has been given in the Finance Act. Similarly, in respect of provision of services also, for the residents, the exception has been given that consideration for provision of services, irrespective of whether services provided or facilitated by the e-commerce operator, shall be included in the consideration received, however, exception to the residents. Any questions, or should we move to the case studies?
Yes, ma'am, we can move.
Sure. Okay. So just one slide more before we move to the case studies. The question arises, are there any threshold limits, or every non-resident e-commerce operator is subject to equalization levy? So the answer is, there are exclusions, and for this, the threshold limit is 2 crores. That is, if the sales, turnover, or the gross receipts of the non-resident e-commerce operator from e-commerce supplier services is less than 2 crore rupees, then there is no requirement, no chargeability for equalization levy, then it's exempt. And where the second exclusion is, where the non-resident is providing services and the non-resident has a permanent establishment in India and the services provided are effectively connected to the Indian PE, in that case, equalization levy will not be applicable. Naturally, because the logic is when the company has a PE in India, that PE is automatically getting taxed, you know, at 42% of the profits on a net basis. So that is why it is not chargeable for equalization levy. And the third exclusion from equalization levy is that where equalization levy is already levied under the erstwhile Finance Act 2016, which is at the rate of 6% on specified services. So if the services are such, if equalization levy is chargeable at 6%, the same services will not again be additionally charged at the rate of 2%. Again, two very important amendments which came by this Finance Act 2021. The first is that where the income is chargeable to tax as royalty or fee for technical service under the Act Red with Treaty, in such a case, the EL provisions shall not be applicable. That is, and this amendment has been brought with effect from 1st April 2020, because last year there was a lot of discussion and there was an anomaly in the sense that the same income was chargeable both to equalization levy and no exemption under the Act. So this has been rectified and it has been clarified that where the income is chargeable to tax as royalty under the Act Red with Treaty, EL provisions shall not be applicable. And this is with effect from April 1, 2020. Further, the income that is exempt will be under Section 1050 of the Income Tax Act, which provides that e-commerce supply or services made or provided or facilitated on or after April 1, 2020, no income tax on such income. So first we have to see the income, whether it qualifies to be royalty or FTS. Under the Act Red with Treaty, if the answer is yes, then it will be subject to royalty FTS, no equalization levy. And if the income is not chargeable to tax as royalty or FTS, then it will be subject to equalization levy, provided all the other conditions as mentioned for the chargeability of equalization levy get satisfied. Any questions here?
Yes, ma'am. So there is one question, although I am not getting what he wants to know. So the question is, earlier we were paying 6% equalization levy on online advertisement services. Mm-hmm. What will be the rate now of no PE in India or in case of PE in India?
No, see, again, if there is a PE in India, then equalization levy is not applicable either for the earlier one, 6%, or the present one, 2%. It has been stated that there is exemption, no equalization levy for such cases. And the second part of the question, where there is no PE and assuming the services get qualified as specified services, which are prescribed by Finance Act 2016, that is online advertising, etc., then EL will be applicable at the rate of 6%.
So, when someone is writing, it is not clear exempt income point. What are those income?
Sure. I'll repeat that. Yeah. Earlier there was a controversy that can the same income, let's say a non-resident provides certain services to an Indian company. And these services, they qualify as fee for technical services under the Act, under the treaty. So it gets captured. So the question was, for the non-resident who's providing such services, whether it will be taxable, one, at the rate of 10% under the Income Tax Act, and secondly, over and above, whether equalization levy of 2% will also be applicable. So the effective tax rate for non-resident is at 12%. So this is the question. So the answer to this question is that where the income is taxable as fee for technical services under the Act, Redwood Treaty, 10% will be applicable under the provisions of the Income Tax Act. On such income, there will be no equalization levy. However, just twisting this example, let's say this income does not satisfy the test of fee for technical services under the Act, Redwood Treaty. Let's say there's an exemption. So there is no 10% taxation because it is not taxable as FTS. But in such a scenario, the non-resident, if it satisfies the definition of the e-commerce operator and online services, the person will have to pay equalization levy of 2%.
Okay. So there is one more question, ma'am. So if an Indian company sells goods via Amazon UAE and getting sales proceeds in INR from Amazon after deducting their commission, then what will be the equalization levy provisions in such case?
Sorry, you will have to repeat the question, please.
Yeah, sure. If an Indian company sells goods via Amazon UAE and getting sales proceeds in INR from Amazon after deducting their commission, and
no,
then
no, I'll just stop here. So you are saying Indian company is selling the goods, right?
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
And Indian company is maybe earning a commission by selling the goods to a UAE company.
Yes, Amazon UAE.
No, see, in this case, no equalization levy because the e-commerce operator who's selling the goods has to be a non-resident. So in the present case, if the goods are sold by the Indian company, then no equalization levy because Indian company is already getting taxed on its profits at whatever the corporate tax rate for the corporate or whatever business presence form it has. So equalization levy provisions, first condition, these 2020 is the person, the e-commerce operator who sells the goods needs to be a non-resident.
And probably he wants to, he is saying that because Amazon UAE, he is naming Amazon UAE. So Amazon UAE would be probably the e-commerce operator, right? And he is selling. So I guess the example should be phrased like that Indian is the owner of the product. He has listed his product in the Amazon UAE portal. And then the product is sold through the Amazon UAE. And then when the proceeds have been collected by the Amazon UAE, and then Amazon UAE transferred the proceeds after deducting their commission to the Indian seller.
No, very valid question. And this is the case study two exactly, which I'm going to cover. So,
okay. Sure.
I will request Amitji, you just pass this question. And if after case study two, it still remains unanswered, I will be happy to answer.
Sure, ma'am. So the another relevant question is, please explain against exempt income 1050 versus royalty and FTS.
Okay. So 1050 is the... See what 1050 states is. Let me again read from the Act. Let me open the Act. Let me read from the Act, you know, so that it gets cleared for this. So what section 1050 says is that there are certain incomes which do not form part of the total income, right? So by Finance Act 2021, an explanation has been inserted. What it says is, it is hereby clarified that the income referred to in this clause shall not include and we shall be deemed to never have been included, which is chargeable to tax as royalty FTS. So what it says is section 10 subsection 50, that if there is an item of income, let's say, which satisfies the definition of fee for technical services or royalty under the Act, Redwood Treaty. So what is the tax liability? That's 10%. Assuming the person doesn't have a P, foreign person, the tax liability is 10% because Income Tax Act says that royalty or FTS is taxable at the rate of 10%. So a non-resident is providing e-commerce supply or services. Otherwise, normally it should have been captured under equalization levy. But what the Act says is, first you see royalty FTS. If it is getting taxed as royalty FTS, 10% tax is there, no equalization levy. Option next, if the services do not satisfy as FTS, that means they will not be taxed under the Act due to whatever, let's say it is not making available technology under the treaty, etc. So it is not getting taxed as FTS. In such cases, equalization levy will be payable at the rate of 2%.
Yeah. Sure. So no more question, ma'am.
We'll move to the case studies with this. No, in fact, one more. I'll just brief on the compliances. This equalization levy is to be paid. It is to be deposited by the non-resident. The payment of the tax is on quarterly basis. For first quarter, the payment needs to be made by 7 July. For second quarter, 7th October. So similarly, for December quarter, 7th January. And for 31st March, by 31st March. Strange, but it says by 31st March. So I don't know how the person will make up the accounts, understand, you know, 31st March I deposit. Though there are certain, you know, obviously because of COVID, these timelines have been extended here. See, again, one pertinent question comes here is then how non-resident will deposit this tax. I'm a non-resident. It becomes very difficult how this can be deposited. But the, you know, provisions are there that there are specified chalans which have been prescribed. I think that's 285 for this. A person needs to fill that chalan, deposit the tax. That means the foreign non-resident operator will also have to obtain a permanent account number for this. Though he may take the help of an agent in India, maybe, you know, to deposit such taxes. But yes, there is a compliance which needs to be undertaken. And then other than quarterly taxes, which has to be paid, the person has to file an annual equalization levy statement in form number one, which is due on or before 30th June of the next financial year. And certain, again, allied provisions in relation to this is that the tax officer can make the computational corrections in the statement. Then if there is any delay in deposit of EL, there will be a simple interest at the rate of 1% per month or part of the month, which will be applicable. And if there is a failure to pay equalization levy, then there will be a penalty equal to the amount of equalization levy. Obviously, if there are reasonable cause to justify that penalty is not levyable, that's a separate case. And failure to file this annual equalization levy statement attracts a penalty of 100 per day for each default. And if a false statement is made, the non-resident may be subjected to imprisonment for a term of 3 years and a fine. So see, the message here is because of these new provisions, it's very important for the foreign companies to understand and estimate that what is their liability, you know, and they must estimate. And if equalization levy is applicable, they must deposit, or, you know, there could be penal consequences against this. So it is very important for all the foreign companies to understand, and even, you know, from a consultant perspective, to apprise their clients, their foreign companies, about these new provisions.
So, ma'am, before moving to this, one query is there that the advertisement / online promotion by Indian company on LinkedIn Ireland, payment debited through the company debit card, amount paid to 185,000. So he's asking whether equalization 2% or 6% will prevail.
If it is an online advertisement, it should be 2%. 6%. Sorry, 6 if it is an online advertisement. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. So moving to the case studies, you know, which will help us understand, and I'm sure here a lot of questions are going to come about the equalization levy. So case study one is, there's a foreign company, X Inc. Assume it has a website for sale of sport shoes. And this is a non-resident. And it's an assumption here that this company satisfies the definition of e-commerce operator. Now, there's an Indian customer. The Indian customer logs into the website, then buys the goods from there and makes a payment of 1,000 to the foreign company. So the question is whether equalization levy would be applicable in such a case or not. So see, if you have to test the conditions, who's providing or who's selling the goods? Non-resident. Is he an e-commerce operator? Yes. What is he supplying? Is it an online sale of goods? Let's say yes. I'll come to that why it could not be said as yes, but broadly we see yes. Then the third condition, the third box, which we saw in the earlier slide was to a specified person where it was resident. So it's an Indian customer, resident of India. So on 1,000 equalization levy ought to be applicable. However, you know, there are certain divergent views. I'll not conclude here, but I would just like to throw a divergent view that when an online sale of good is made, specifically in case of, let's say, sports shoes we are referring to here is, so do we say it's only the contract which is getting concluded online, or it is actually, you know, the sale of good will happen physically. Somebody will have to apportion the goods, you know, physically and then deliver it. So this is one of, I'll not conclude again, as I said, but this is a one thought to think here, whether equalization levy could be said to be not applicable by taking an argument that though the order is placed online, but still, how will the sale happen online? But again, we have to be mindful about, you know, the Finance Act 2021, the very wide provision. So this is the next case study, maybe one of the questions that was raised by the participant. So this is X Inc., a foreign company, a non-resident e-commerce operator. This is an online marketplace model. Now sellers, let's say Indian sports shoes manufacturer, who's an Indian resident seller, list their product on the website of X Inc. Now customer, third party is now Indian customers. Indian customer can access the portal of X Inc. and place the order for purchase of desired products. So what will happen is Indian customer will make the payment to X Inc. for purchase of shoes, let's say 500 rupees. And IX Inc. remits the payment of 450 to the Indian shoes manufacturer. So what is happening in this case is 50 rupees, which X Inc. has earned from Indian customer, is, let's say, a commission or, you know, a convenience fee, which it mentions on its terms and use of website that I will charge 50 rupees to the Indian customer for booking this transaction, and it collects 500 rupees, makes a payment of 450 rupees to the Indian sports shoe manufacturer. The question here is whether EL is applicable first. If yes, whether on 500 rupees, which is collected from the Indian customer, or only on rupees 50 collected from the Indian customer, because rupees 450 is passed on to the Indian sports shoe manufacturer, who's the e-commerce participant. So let's just test the conditions, how it goes. First condition, non-resident e-commerce operator, X Inc. Yes, the condition gets satisfied. The second is whom to whom it is providing these services, to the Indian customer. And when it is providing services to the Indian customer for this online platform, what it is earning, 50 rupees as commission. So certainly on 50 rupees, equalization levy should be applicable. Then the larger question comes whether this 450, which the person collects from the Indian customer, whether equalization levy is applicable or not. So before I give the answer, maybe any thoughts from any of the audience? What do you think on 450, it should be applicable or not?
So any, I guess
answers, Amit ji, which we are receiving?
500 is the answer, ma'am. Praveen Agrawal ji is saying it will be applicable on 500 full amount.
Okay.
Saurabh Mittal ji is also saying 500. Abhishek Agrawal is saying 450. So majority of the answer is going for 500.
So my answer maybe is different from all the answers. I will say in this case, equalization levy should be applicable only on 50 rupees and not on 450, not on 500. I'll give the reasoning why. Maybe the participants agree or, you know, thoughts are welcome. So see, why 50 rupees I'm saying? One, it's clear that 50 is earned from Indian customer. That means Xing is providing online services to Indian customer and it is earning a consideration of 50 rupees. One. Secondly, if I go as per this budget amendment of Finance Act 2021, it says where this Xing is just a facilitator and the payments which it has to make here, this person is a resident, 450 rupees. So there is an exemption provided in this, Act, Finance Act 2021, which says that any consideration which is received or receivable by this non-resident for facilitating, but where this party is an Indian resident, then there is an exception, then equalization levy is not applicable. And there could be another secondary argument also to this. When Xing is collecting 500 rupees from Indian customer, this 450 rupees is never, you know, on its own account. It will never form part of its consideration. It may just be a contra entry. You know, it receives, it gives back the money. So it is never receiving. And by Finance Act 21, this is a dispensation here provided.
Yeah.
Okay. Should I move to case study 2-3?
Ma'am, so another question on this only, that if the customers are outside India, so if the foreign customer apart in place of Indian customer.
Yes, I have this case study. This is the next case study. So okay. We'll cover this.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. Okay. So again, first I will cover this case study and maybe as a next case study, I will take that foreign customer. So this is very interesting case study 3. There is X Inc is a non-resident e-commerce operator which owns, manages the online marketplace portal. So sellers list their product on website Inc. And who are the sellers? In this case, foreign sport shoes manufacturer. So in the last example, which we discussed, the person here who was listing their products was a resident person. Here it's the non-resident person, the foreign shoes manufacturer. This is very important. And then the third party to the transaction is Indian customers. So the Indian customers, they place an order for purchase of shoes. They make payment of 500 rupees to X Inc. X Inc. remits the payment of 450 to the foreign sports manufacturer. And again, in this case, X Inc. is earning a commission of 50 rupees from Indian customer under the contractual arrangement. So first question is, again, equalization be levy applicable? If yes, whether on 500, whether on 450, whether on 50, or no equalization levy? Any thoughts?
First answer is 500 and second answer is not applicable. Third one again goes for 500. And so majority view is 500.
Okay. So see, again, in this case, maybe let's test the conditions and see what's the answer. Xing is a non-resident e-commerce operator. It is earning commission from a resident party, that's Indian customers, 50 rupees. So one thing it is sure, for 50 rupees, the equalization levy should be applicable. Now the second condition, the second part is on 450 rupees, whether it should be applicable or not. So in case study 2, we discussed that on 450 rupees, it should not be applicable. One reason was specifically the exemption has been provided by Finance Act 2021, but that was only in respect of resident parties. So 450, which Exim collects and pays to foreign sports shoe manufacturer, view one, it should be applicable because the exemption which has been provided in the Act, Equalization Levy Act, is only for resident parties, not for non-resident parties. So it should be applicable. But view two here is that 450 is not a consideration. Again, the same argument which I mentioned in case study two, that it is not a consideration which it is receiving on its own behalf. It is only a consideration which is received for the third party. So why equalization levy? But adopting this view could be controversial, because the thought of the revenue authorities may be that, you know, when the specific exemption has been provided for resident parties, then why for foreign parties it should not be there? So both the views are there. View one is only 50 rupees should be applicable. View two is it should be applicable on the entire 500 rupees. So I will just, want to make a little twist to this question. Here we mentioned the answers that, two answers. View one was it should be levied only on 50 rupees. View two was it should be applicable on the entire 500. So in this case, let's say the terms of the contract are such that this 50 rupees, which X Inc. earns as a commission, is not from the Indian customer, but this is from the foreign sports shoe manufacturer. So X Inc. says, okay, Indian customer, I will list your products. This foreign shoes manufacturer, I will list your products on my website, but I will charge a commission of, let's say, 50 rupees for every completed sale. And then it allows the Indian customers to come on its website, make the purchases, but there is no consideration which is charged from the Indian customer. So when from the Indian customer, nothing is being charged, in fact, for that entire transaction. So there's no equalization levy. And for the second part, where 50 rupees commission under a contractual arrangement is earned from the foreign sports shoes manufacturer, no equalization levy should be applicable, because here the services are being provided to a non-resident, assuming it doesn't satisfy the specified conditions which we discussed in the earlier slides. Any questions here?
No, ma'am, there is no question as such.
Okay. So then I'll move to case study four, which was a query raised when the customer is a foreign one. So X Inc. is a non-resident e-commerce operator. It sells their products on the websites of X Inc., the Indian sports shoe manufacturer. The customers, they access the portal, they purchase the order. Here the customers are foreign customers. So where the commission is charged, let's say, for online provision of services to the foreign customers being non-resident, in such a case, equalization levy ought not to be applicable, because though, you know, the condition is satisfied for X Inc. to be an e-commerce operator, the second condition of providing online services to the foreign customer is also satisfied. But the third condition, that service should be rendered to a resident or to a non-resident only in specified circumstances. So because these are foreign customers, non-resident, the condition will not be satisfied. Hence, no equalization levy. So with this, I'll move to case study five, which is almost similar to, you know, one of the case studies discussed earlier, that the Indian customer books a travel ticket, it pays a convenience fee to X Inc., non-resident e-commerce operator. So let's say 50 rupees is the convenience fee commission which X Inc. charges from Indian customer. Equalization levy should be applicable. And on, let's say, 5,000 rupees, the ticket cost or the hotel cost, which is collected by X Inc. from Indian customers and passed on to the Indian hotel, equalization levy should not be applicable because of the specific exemption given to the Indian hotels, Indian participants. So this case study six is, you know, I will not just discuss in too detail, but just a very simple, I would put it like this, let's say, again, for software payments, these days, after the Supreme Court judgment, software has been held as not taxable as royalty. So let's take a very plain vanilla example that a person purchases software and foreign company owns, operates a website and supplies the software. In such cases, equalization levy ought to be applicable because that has been specifically made exempt from the royalty definition. So we'll not go into this detailed study maybe, yeah. So any questions still here, then we will discuss the TDS provisions under the new law.
Here I have one question that in case of online sales, if someone is selling their own product from their own portal, so in your case study, if I take example of that, Adidas Germany is selling the product through their own portal. They have the portal. So in the past, there has been it has been held that website own cannot be held as permanent establishment or it will be not, it cannot be said that they have sold the product in India. So if we consider that now this coming into the equalization levy era, so whether if someone is selling their own product through their portal, also that will be covered under the equalization levy, or when we read the definition of equalization levy e-com operator, then it will be only and only applicable. So what is the view and what sort of interpretation should be there?
Yeah, see, my view here is that the example which you gave, that the person non-resident is selling the goods through its own portal, yes, it should fall under equalization levy provisions, because what the law of EL says is that a person is a non-resident e-commerce operator. He owns, he manages a website. So where the conditions are being satisfied that he owns a website or, you know, manages his website and through his portal he is selling the goods to a person resident in India, then equalization levy should be applicable. You know, because we always had that thought in mind that I started in the beginning, you know, it is not meant for me as a non-resident. It is only for the Amazons of the world which is meant. But that is not the case. The way the provisions are worded, it captures a lot, you know, even where the non-resident is selling to third parties, it could also be a case within the group, you know, a foreign parent selling the goods to its own subsidiary through a portal. Even that could get captured under equalization levy. The provisions worded are very, very wide.
Yeah. So, and another question is, although you have already briefed it about in the your previous discussion, so I want to confirm is if I as a buyer or I have as a receiver of service, if I am contracting, then in any case of services wherein if I have a sense that it is equal, it is an online service, right? Yeah. But I am confused as a buyer that whether it is that equalization levy of 2% will be applicable or royalty or FTS will be applicable. So whether So which act will preside? Means first I should test whether it meets the equalization levy, or first I should test that the provisions of Income Tax Act, royalty, FTS and PE thing. So what law will provide? Whether I have to test first equalization levy test, or I have to test it first Income Tax Act?
Yeah, see, it is basically first it will be seen under the Income Tax Act. The reason is because in Equalization Levy Act, as well as in Section 1050, Finance Act 2021 has clarified, and I will, you know, just read what Finance Act 2021, the change, just let me see. This Section 163 of the Equalization Levy Act, what it says is, after Subsection 3 says, provided that the consideration received or receivable for e-commerce supply or services shall not include the consideration which are taxable as royalty or FTS under the Income Tax Act.
Yeah.
So, hai na, Amit ji, jab ye pichle saal clarity nahi thi, ek to controversy aayi, ye 10% aur 2%, kya hum 12% tax denge?
Right.
Aur ek, you know, people were interpreting ki bhai hum 10% kyun dein? Hum to 2% de dete hain equalization levy.
Yes.
You know, why to go in for 10%? But yes. The law is, you know, clarified or worded in a way now आप पहले ही अगर तो वो रॉयल्टी एफटीएस है तो 10% देंगे, आपको 2% पे नहीं ऐसे छोड़ेंगे, और अगर 10% नहीं है, आप कुछ भी नहीं हो रहे टैक्स, तो फिर कुछ तो टैक्स देना पड़ेगा अगर आप डिजिटल सर्विसेज यहाँ देते हैं, तो 2% तो आपको देना ही पड़ेगा यहाँ पे.
So for the participants, it's a very factual and brainstorming exercise. So facts should be very clear whether it would essentially, what is the essential characters. So that is my view, and I guess Gitika madam is also seconding the same view. So okay, ma'am. So now we are moving towards the TDS provisions.
So again, you know, under the Income Tax Act, So under the Income Tax Act, this 194O provisions have been introduced. White Finance Act 2020, Section 194O has been inserted in the Act with effect from October 1, 2020, that provides for the withholding of taxes at the rate of 1% by an e-commerce operator on the gross amount of sale or services or both made by an e-commerce participant that has been facilitated by the e-commerce operator through its digital platform. So I'll just make this simple by way of this diagram. So let's say this e-commerce operator is making a payment to an e-commerce participant. First, what are the conditions? There is a sale of goods or provision of services. Such sale of goods or provision of services is of whom? They are of the e-commerce participant. They are not of the e-commerce operator. They are of the e-commerce participant. And such sale or provision of services of the e-commerce participant is facilitated by the e-commerce operator. And such facilitation happens through the digital or electronic facility of the e-commerce operator. So the e-commerce operator, if these conditions are satisfied, will have to make a TDS, will have to deduct TDS at the rate of 1% on the amounts debited or paid to the e-commerce participant, whichever is early. So who's an e-commerce operator? That's defined. That means a person who owns, operates, or manages digital or electronic facility or platform for electronic commerce. Electronic commerce has also been defined as the supply of goods or services or both, including digital products over digital or electronic network. Then e-commerce participant is defined, and it's very important here, it means a person resident in India. So I've specifically kept this in caps. The word resident is very important. E-commerce participant means a person resident in India selling the goods or providing the services, including digital products through digital facility for the purposes of e-commerce. Maybe 30 seconds break I will take so that everybody can view at the provisions, because they are very, very important and little complex. So, you know, the examples which come to mind here will be, we book a taxi, let's say Ola, Uber, we book a taxi. And who's the e-commerce participant here? That will be the person who's providing the service, the driver. Who's the e-commerce operator? The ultimate foreign company. Let's say Uber for naming, or any other foreign company, ABC. Ola is obviously an Indian company, or even Ola we can take, because e-commerce operator here is not defined to be a non-resident as it was under equalization levy. So here it says e-commerce operator means both resident or non-resident, but e-commerce participant should be a resident one. So I, let's say an Indian customer, I book a taxi, I go to the app of the e-commerce operator, let's say Ola, I book a cab, and either I can make an online payment to Ola, Ola will make the payment to driver, or I can make the payment to driver directly, also cash payment. So in this case, three parties, e-commerce operator, let's say Ola, e-commerce participant, the driver, and Indian customer. I book the cab. TDS in this transaction is specified between two parties. That's when e-commerce operator makes the payment to e-commerce participant. Ola makes the payment to driver. Hope this simplifies. The exception which has been provided in this case is that no TDS if transaction with the individual or the HUF is less than or equal to 5 lakh rupees during the year, and such persons furnish either their PAN number or Aadhaar. Otherwise, for corporates, there is no exemption. The TDS needs to be deducted. And in the absence of PAN, the TDS will be deducted at a higher rate of 5%. So, Amitji, with this, should we move to the case study?
Yes, ma'am, we can. So we have one or two questions.
Sure.
So one question is, under section 194O, whether e-commerce operator will deduct the TDS if it is an India e-com operator?
Yes. The answer is yes.
Okay. So under 194O, NRI not necessary anywhere in this section. So I guess he's clarifying the position of the...
Yeah. Basically clarifying, yes. So, you know, for e-commerce operator, the answer is correct. Somebody is clarifying, that's correct. That e-commerce operator has not been defined as resident or non-resident. Whereas for equalization levy provisions, it was specified as non-resident. But in 194O provisions, e-commerce participant has been defined as resident. And you know, the logic for the same is because the person who's earning the income here is the e-commerce participant. इनकम ड्राइवर की है, लेट्स से एक होटल है, होटल ने अपने आप को लिस्ट किया, इनकम किसकी है, होटल की है, तो वो कह रहे हैं होटल जो ये रेजिडेंट है विच इज अर्निंग इनकम, सो दे आर प्रोवाइडिंग दैट टैक्स डिडक्शन शुड बी देयर बिफोर हैंड ऑन सच ट्रांजैक्शंस.
वन क्वेश्चन इज, मैम, माय क्लाइंट इज मैन्युफैक्चरिंग कंपनी एंड हैड टाई अप विद ओला, देन इन केस वी डिडक्ट अंडर टीडीएस 194O, सो आई गेस nature of agreement is of utmost important here.
Yes, you are very right. You are very right, Amit. The nature of agreement is very important. And if the client is deducting tax, I mean, one has to see whether it satisfies the definitions of e-commerce operator, of owning, operating, managing a platform, and the contractual terms in equalization levy, as well as 194O. One has to very carefully read through. You know, because it's very important when we talked in the earlier slide also, how are you receiving commission? Is it from the Indian customer, from the e-commerce participant? So here the contractual terms will play an important role.
And most importantly, the business should be directly related with their e-commerce business, not with other business. So all kind of agreement with the Ola would not covered under this section or either 194O or even for the sake of equalization levy.
Absolutely, you know, because even if the person has a contract with Ola, if the person says, okay, I will deduct tax under 194O, the person is not an e-commerce operator. I mean, for 194O, though, under separate section, if the tax is deductible, that's a separate thing.
Okay. So probably, Ashutoshji, what we can do in the last, we will, you can ask your question directly by unmuting yourself. So we should move ahead. Please park your this question, and in the last we can discuss this in QA session. Okay.
So other some of the key points to be discussed here are what is the timing of deduction? It's the credit or payment, whichever is earlier. And again, the law has clarified and it has provided for certain deeming provisions. That is, even if the direct payment is made by the customers to e-commerce participant, it shall be deemed as if it's the payment by the e-commerce operator. So let's say I book a cab, I make a payment directly to Ola, and then, you know, the questions were like, how? Because the e-commerce operator is not making a payment, it's a cash payment, but there are deeming provisions which have been inserted that it will be deemed as the payment to be made, you know, to the e-commerce operator. And then it has also been specified in the act, e-commerce operator is deemed to be the person responsible for paying to an e-commerce participant. So same example, I pay to the Ola driver, then it says e-commerce operator is deemed. Actual to wo nahi hai, payment to wo nahi kar raha, to tax kaise kaatega? Wo kehte usse deem kiya jayega, it will be deemed as if the payment is made, he is the person responsible for paying to an e-commerce participant. Again, from the rate at which the tax is to be deducted, 1% or we discussed 5% in absence of PAN, I thought it is relevant to just mention here that there is a new provision which has been inserted in this Act, Section 206AB. And it is for, I think, all the TDS provisions which mentions that if payment is made to specified persons, then the tax deduction has to be at a higher rate, that is twice the rate provided in the Act, or twice the rates in force, or 5%. And how they have defined specified person is, if the person has not filed the return of income for 2 years prior to the year in which tax is required to be deducted, the time for filing the original return of income has expired, and TDS is more than 50K in each of the 2 years. So they say, let's say the TDS was supposed to be deducted at 1%. Ola, let's say it's making a payment, or let's say any Make My Trip is making my payment to hotels. So it was supposed to deduct tax at 1%, but Make My Trip has to take the information from the specified person that whether return of income has been filed for the last 2 years. If not, tax deduction will be at a higher rate of 5%. It's important because this is a recent provision which has been inserted. So this is the case study one. This is ex-India e-commerce operator. So specifically, I've taken the example that the e-commerce operator is an Indian person here, doesn't make a difference. It owns, manages the website for travel bookings. There are Indian customers who can access the website of ex-India and make bookings for the desired flights or the hotels. And then the Indian customer books the hotel. Ex-India makes payment to the hotels or the airlines. So the question is whether ex-India making a payment to Indian hotel is required to deduct tax? The answer is yes. And the section says on the gross amount of payments, the tax needs to be deducted. So Indian customer though is making a payment to ex-India, but ex-India is required to deduct tax on the payments when it makes to Indian hotel. Let's say Indian customers pay 500 rupees, 50 is the commission of ex-India, and 450 is the amount to be paid to Indian hotel. Because 50 is just the commission which ex-India is earning, that should not be subjected. But on 450 rupees, ex-India ought to deduct TDS while making payment to the Indian hotels. Case study two, X Inc. is a non-resident e-commerce operator. It owns, manages a website for travel booking. Customers can access the website and make bookings for the desired flights or the hotels. The Indian customer books a foreign hotel or airline ticket, that's the e-commerce participant, foreign hotel, and Indian customer makes the payment to X Inc. X Inc. remits the amount to foreign hotels. So the question is whether TDS needs to be deducted by X Inc. The answer is no, because in this case, e-commerce participant is a non-resident, and the necessary condition for 194O is that e-commerce participant should be a resident party. Uh, So, you know, just in this example, let's say if instead of a foreign hotel, this is an Indian hotel, then yes, TDS provisions will be applicable. And again, the question is that X Inc. is a non-resident, how it will do the withholding? Because practically, we have seen mostly, you know, that's the Indian residents while making payment to the foreign parties deduct TDS. But now it's the reverse case, the foreign party making a payment to a Indian person. So the person has to deduct tax. So though, you know, one may take the arguments, which we will not go through here, that extraterritorial jurisdiction, etc. But leaving those arguments, X-Inc. Will have to undertake the withholding tax compliances. And in that case, even Section 204, you know, by Finance Act 2020, provided that in case of non-residents, an agent of a person can undertake the compliances. So X-Inc. Will have to obtain TAN number, all necessary things it needs to take, and do the tax withholding. Any questions, or should I move to the next case study?
Yes, ma'am, there are questions.
Okay, sure. Yeah.
So someone is asking whether equalization levy will be levied in case study two.
In case study two. Yes. Okay. So, yes. So, again, answering this question, in fact, I think I have a chart, I don't know, interplay between equalization levy and this. So see, the query that in case study two, whether equalization would be levied, the answer is yes. Assuming, let's say the person, the X Inc. Earns a commission from Indian customers of 50 rupees for booking of the hotels. So 50 rupees, which is earned as a commission by X Inc., that should be subject to equalization levy. 450, total it earns 500. 50 rupees it earns at its commission, 450 it gives to foreign hotel. 450 we discussed two views, whether equalization levy should be applicable or not. But at the same time, in this example, case study two, no 194O because it's a foreign hotel and not an Indian e-commerce participant.
Okay. So I have one question or ma'am here that as you said that in case of non-resident 204 has also been notified. So now I want to understand that discussion about the extra territorial TDS provisions, like the Indian government, how Indian government can apply a TDS provision on a non-resident who is doing entire his business from outside India. So how do you think that how it will going to stand means in coming time, it's going to be a long controversy. So how do you stand means given the current set of ruling and probably the tax administration it is also settled that in case of non-residents, the extraterritorial taxation would not work out. So how do you think that this 194O, their intent to apply the TDS on non-resident will going to stand. So what are your views? And I would also like to know what is the major view. And while advising to client, what should be the our take while advising to client?
See, one, this extraterritorial and all, I would, though I'll express my personal views, but as you know, it's more of, you know, a legal issue rather than commenting there more. I would say, yes, the arguments do exist that, you know, when a non-resident has to do a tax withholding, why even one needs to go to Section 204? Because Section 204, you need to resort, you know, when it states that specifically person responsible for deducting tax. In the present case, Section 194O itself states that who's the person responsible for deducting tax? That's the e-commerce operator.
E-commerce.
So why do you need to even go to Section 204? So, you know, if one has to really argue, there could be some set of arguments. But again, a counter argument could be that if we see the memorandum of Finance Act 2020, which inserted this provision of 194O, and at the same time 204, the memorandum explaining the provisions of the Finance Act said that for the purposes of 194O, Section 204 has been amended. So it's only in the memorandum. If you read law, law doesn't say, if you go in the act, doesn't say that for 194O, you need to read 204, but memorandum states. So, you know, that's why I'm saying there are arguments existing on both these sides. And again, for non-residents, why a non-resident should be, you know, made liable to do all the compliances, Indian compliances. It is doing everything outside. And now you're telling to do the non-resident all compliances. It becomes very difficult and maybe relying on some Supreme Court judgments again, though in a different context, but a relatable context, whether arguments could be placed. My personal view is, when you say whether non-resident should be liable to tax withholding under 194O, there are arguments available both in favor and against, some of which we discussed whether withholding is to be levied or not. But yes, if the clients take a position that there is not going to be any withholding, they are not going to comply, it is going to result in a long-drawn litigation. So it depends, you know, on the client to client, whether they are ready for this litigation. And, you know, specifically considering these withholding tax provisions, I mean, it's the income of someone else. I just have to withhold tax, because if I withhold tax, the other person is going to get a credit in his 26 years of the tax withholding. So if I think personally, I would say, why I should go into liquidation? Bhai, maine uska tax katna hai, usko credit bhi mil jana hai. The problem is I have to do the compliances. So one has to really weigh, you know, simple agar aapko ek compliance karna hai, ya aapko itna litigation mein jana hai, jo aapka khud ka tax bhi nahi hai. Kisi aur ka tax kaatne hai uski income pe. To kar do compliance, matlab, why to get into all these litigation? Yeah.
Yeah, sure. So broadly, what I understood that it's the cost benefit analysis rather than the going to the legal interpretation. And it's a cost benefit analysis, what we need to advise to the client before taking the final view.
Absolutely. I will say this, because legally there are arguments available on both the sides. If you will say, argue that tax withholding is not applicable, I'll put arguments for that. If you will say, no, it's applicable, I will again put arguments. No, ye to applicable hai. So it's more of a cost benefit analysis, right?
Right. So someone is asking, please repeat case study one.
Sure. So case study one is that X India is an e-commerce operator. X is an Indian entity. It owns, manages a website for travel bookings. Indian customer books an Indian hotel on the website of X India. Right? So Indian customer, let's say, pays 10,000 to X India for booking of the Indian hotel, and X India remits 10,000 rupees to the Indian hotel. So the first question is, the X India, when it makes payment of 10,000 to Indian hotel, whether it is required to deduct TDS? So the answer is yes. Why? Because first, e-commerce operator definition is satisfied by X India. Yes. Second, the e-commerce participant is an Indian resident, and X India has facilitated, you know, the provision of services of Indian hotel. Therefore, it needs to deduct tax while making payments. Does that help, or Any further questions on this case study one, or should we move to case study three?
Yes. So Rajeshji, I guess it is fine with you, right? Yes. Yes, ma'am. We should move ahead.
Sure. So this is an example of a cab aggregator. Let's say X Inc. This is a foreign e-commerce operator. It's a cab aggregator. The Indian customer goes to the portal of X Inc. and they book a cab, and the actual service provided is by the drivers, who will qualify to be e-commerce participants in this. So first question could be that when X Inc. makes payment to drivers, whether it is liable to withhold tax? The answer is yes. Just a twist to this, where let's say Indian customers directly make payment to the drivers, whether in such a situation X Inc. should be liable to withhold tax while making payment to the drivers? So the answer should be yes, they should withhold tax. Only, you know, in a very unique circumstance, one could take a position that no withholding. See how the withholding provision work is when X Inc. has to either debit or make a payment to the driver. So assume a situation, it is all cash payment. Every time Indian customer makes the payment to driver, and never a situation arises that the Indian customer will make the payment to X Inc. and X Inc. will make the payment to driver. Then X Inc., you know, technically there arises a problem. How do I withhold tax? I don't have to debit. I don't have to make any payment to driver. Rather, the commission which X Inc. was supposed to earn from Indian customer, because the customer has paid in cash to the driver. So X Inc. will say, I in fact have to recover the money from you and not make the payment to you. So, you know, only in such circumstances where there are cash payments, Indian customers make payment to the drivers, and there is no scenario where X Inc. will be liable to make any payment to drivers, there one may take some argument that no withholding ought to be applicable. But assuming it's a mix of cash and online payment modes, then yes, X Inc. will have to deduct tax while making payments to drivers. And Finance Act 2020, which also clarified that even in case the payment is made by Indian customer to drivers, X Inc. shall be deemed to be the person responsible for making payments to the drivers, and therefore withholding tax provisions ought to be applicable. So any other question on this?
So Santoshji, you can unmute yourself and ask the question directly. So the question and question answer session has started. So you can ask your question. Please unmute yourself and ask the question.
Just a minute. I will allowing all the participants. Yes, now all the participants are allowed to unmute and ask your
question. Hi, Bhutika madam.
Hello, sir.
Yeah, so my question is like equalization levy is applicable on non-resident, right?
That's right.
So my question, how department will control over the non-resident for collection of taxes and all?
Sir, very valid question, you know. In fact, by and again, I have been asked this question by many people. Pata kaise lagega unko? Control kaise karenge government? Aap tax de na de, aap to bahar baithi hain. So, sir, my answer would be here. Dekhiye, wo laga lenge pata, jaise bhi lagayenge. You know, there could be, I don't know these days, there are so many memorandum of exchange between different departments, exchange of information, I don't know from where to where. जैसे भी वो पता तो लगा लेंगे एंड वी हैव टू बी यू नो जस्ट की प्रोविजंस आर देयर सो वी शुड बी एडवाइजिंग आवर क्लाइंट्स हाउ टू डिपॉजिट द टैक्स एंड डू द कंप्लायंस अदरवाइज यू नो देयर इज ऑल इंटरेस्ट पेनल्टी ऑब्लिगेशंस सो यू नो विद अ वाइड एक्सचेंज ऑफ इंफॉर्मेशन वी डोंट इवन कम टू नो हाउ मतलब आरबीआई रिपोर्ट्स हाउ इंफॉर्मेशन बिटवीन डिपार्टमेंट्स गेट एक्सचेंज्ड इट कैन
Yeah, because as per my understanding, in case of group company and related party transaction, it can be covered through the Indian company.
Yes.
But non-resident who is independent totally, how can government control over that? So that is my basic question, because I understand equalization levy, it's fine. Mm-hmm. But what is the control from the department side? That is, I wanted to understand.
सर वही मैं आपको यही कह रही हूँ प्रैक्टिकली बहुत लोग यही क्वेश्चन पूछते हैं इसका द आंसर विच ऑलवेज वी हैड बीन गिविंग एंड वी हैड बीन सेइंग इज कि अब वो कैसे पता करते हैं किस रिपोर्ट से कहाँ कोई फाइल होती है कहाँ सेल होती है यू नेवर नो यू नो दे स्टार्ट इशूइंग नोटिसेस टू एनी ऑफ द नॉन रेजिडेंट बिकॉज इन द पास्ट वी हैव सीन इन अ वेरी डिफरेंट कॉन्टेक्स्ट देयर वर लॉट ऑफ नोटिसेस इशूड टू वेरियस फॉरेन कंपनीज in respect of a particular manner that you know you have not paid taxes on your income I mean you never know there's a long list of companies everything is available on internet you name a company you want to search about it what are its operations everything you get on a website so ye to sir hai ki challenge ab pakad payenge ya nahi pakad payenge but the intent is yes if the law is one should analyze and comply
okay thank you for clarification
Thank you, Santoshji. Thank you.
Hi, Geetika.
Sachinji, welcome. Yes. Welcome to you. Kindly switch on your camera, sir. Sachin bhai.
Geetika, can I add something in Because whenever one person make a payment to a non-resident, either by way of credit card or by any means, the information goes from the bank to the RBI, and RBI used to share this information to the income tax department. And based on such information, department will come to know that how much transaction has been done for a particular non-resident. And based on that, the government can issue a notice to that person. So this is the way they can track.
Thank you. Absolutely. Yeah.
In fact, one more important thing here is with respect to the e-commerce operators most of them have set up their back office in India. And if you see, that Twitter or all the social media non-resident companies, they will say that they do not have precisely any business in India. But when you see the LinkedIn profile of the people, then you will see that in the Twitter India itself, there are at least 400 or 500 people are working in India. So if they are not doing any business in India, or they do not have any sort of business connection in India, what the people are doing, although legally they are in the contract with the parent entity, but if you go by substance, they probably are working in one way or other in India. So that sort of I can say substance or document is always there. So as Sachinji also said, that the bank payments are there, exchange of information is there with the department. Now the CBC report has been mandated, and it has been broadly covered by all the department. So broadly all this sort of information is available with the department. Aur department ko to bas ek naam chahiye, aur notice to kisi ko bhi issue kar denge. Jaise Sachin sir ne kaha na, payment koi karega usse bolenge agent ho aap. 163-204 वाले एजेंट हो आपने पेमेंट करी है, आपने क्यों नहीं टीडीएस काटा है, आपने क्यों नहीं लेवी चेक की उस टाइम पे.
बट अमित जी, अगर मैं आपकी आपकी पॉइंट को आगे बढ़ाऊं, तो इसमें अगर उसका यहां पे कोई एस्टैब्लिशमेंट है, देन इट कैन बी सेड दैट ईदर इट इज अ सब्सिडियरी कंपनी और अ परमानेंट एस्टैब्लिशमेंट. इफ इट इज अ सब्सिडियरी कंपनी देन आउट ऑफ क्वेश्चन. इफ इट इज अ परमानेंट एस्टैब्लिशमेंट देन अगेन रेगुलेशन लेवी टॉक्स अबाउट सेज दैट इन केस इफ द पी इज देयर देन इट इज नॉट बी एप्लीकेबल.
Right. And effectively so, connected. Important
yes.
services should be effectively connected with the P.
Correct. Yes. So yes.
No, my answer was with that part only, ki how they can trace the party.
Correct.
My question was limited to that aspect. That
you
was right. Not legal at
all. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Any other query?
Yeah, one small question again. See, there is a MNC, MNC company. So manufacturing unit is outside India, and subsidiary company situated in India, incorporated in India, and purchasing the goods and selling into the India and services, providing the services. But Indian company not doing any online transactions, either through email or either through PO. They are procuring goods and paying import duty and selling into India and providing services. So in that case, is it equalization levy is applicable?
So see, if I understand the question, there is a foreign company. It is supplying the goods to the Indian subsidiary. Indian yeah. subsidiary in turn makes physical sales to the various parties in India. So the question is whether equalization levy is applicable on the transaction between parent and subsidiary.
Yeah.
See, where the goods are supplied through the portal of the dot resident, let's say everything was automated. It is supplied through online portal. You go, you click, and goods are delivered. There could be equalization levy. Technical arguments which we discussed in first of these slides was whether one can argue that how is the sale happening online, the goods will be delivered physically, such sort of equalization levy should be applicable where the goods could maybe downloaded in an online form. Though those arguments are there, one can argue, but where there is a full-fledged portal, goods are being delivered, yes, the equalization levy may be applicable. And the second part, wherein you mentioned if there is no, let's say website portal, it is just a PO is being raised by way of an email, and yeah. email that is satisfied, then one may take the argument that it is only a mode of communication by way of which the e-commerce operator is doing. It is not owning a platform through which the online sale of goods takes place. It is only through email that a confirmation is being given. In such cases, the arguments exist to support non-applicability of it.
Okay. And to avoid the equalization levy, one can also physically visit the foreign country and just place an order and then the procure the goods.
Yeah.
I'm just thinking in thought. I'm just wondering, it can happen in other way.
See, basically what they are saying is because of the digital economy. So actually what is the intent is that the digital economy is expanding in a way that foreign companies, they are earning a lot by selling to the, let's say, Indian customers or doing business within the market jurisdictions, but they are not getting taxed. So the idea was this, that in such case, in digitization, the foreign companies be subjected to a tax, and that is why it's called a digital tax. And it was the intention that only meant for certain companies, but the way it has worded out, not many companies could get captured.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Most welcome.
So, any other participants? There were, in case any other participant question is left unanswered, then please, I would request to ask your questions here. I guess probably there are no questions, so we shall move forward this session.
Yeah, ma'am, there's one question. Can you explain the interplay between TDS and equalization levy with focus on e-commerce operator status, that is the residential status?
Where the e-commerce operator is, so just give me a second, maybe I'll just see if I can display by way of a, you know, table, or at least just give me a second.
Yeah, sure, ma'am, sure.
Yeah. Just one second more, because that will help a lot. I'm just seeing if I can display or not display, otherwise I'll just discuss that.
So Sachinji, probably till then you can take one question. That there is one question, that can you comment anything on GAFA taxation? Sagarji wants to know about GAFA taxation.
Sorry, I haven't heard this GAFA taxation. Ma'am can elaborate more.
Sorry, maybe I'll just come to the question. We'll come to this. I'm just coming to the interplay. So see, where the e-commerce is a resident, e-commerce operator is resident, seller, that is e-commerce participant, is non-resident. No withholding. Reason is e-commerce participant is non-resident. And no equalization levy, because the person who's providing the service, e-commerce operator, is resident. So eco-resident, seller non-resident, neither withholding tax nor equalization levy. Second, where the e-commerce operator is resident, and the seller is resident, withholding tax applicable, because seller is resident, and no equalization levy because e-commerce operator is resident. Third situation, e-commerce operator is non-resident, seller is resident, then both applies 194O as well as this equalization levy. 194O because seller is resident, and equalization levy because e-commerce operator is non-resident. And fourth scenario, where
Amitji, please
Please unmute yourself.
Where ECO is non-resident, scenario 4, where ECO is non-resident and seller is non-resident, no withholding tax because seller is a non-resident, and equalization levy, yes, because ECO is a non-resident. So maybe, Amitji, what I discussed, maybe what I'll do is, before sending this presentation to you, if you may be willing to circulate, I have a table on this, you know, so maybe I will insert in a slider table that what is the interplay of equalization levy and withholding tax. That tabular form will help. Somehow in the slide, it's not there, which I presented.
So another question was about the GAFA taxation. So someone wants to know what is GAFA taxation.
Sorry, if somebody could just clarify what is the...
Yes, ma'am. Actually, the same participant has written that Google, Apple, Facebook and...
Okay, Amazon we understood. Tax. Okay, GAFA. Okay.
Yeah,
so this is equalization levy only. What we, you know, call it as these taxes, yes. This is equalization levy.
Yeah. I think it is popularly known as GAFA. Otherwise, we never heard this terminology.
Yeah, so you know, normally Google tax, what we...
Google tax, yeah. Digital service tax. So this these are a few of the name of the digital taxation. So probably I do not know. I read somewhere that one or two of the countries have also applied imposed with the same name, GAFA or FANG or Google tax. But few of the countries have when they have imposed the unilateral measure, then they have used this word. But so now. Next question.
There is no other query. So we would like to conclude.
Yes.
Session.
Yeah.
Thank you to each participant. First of all, thank you to Githika ma'am for giving me wonderful time. And Sachin ji is here, so I request Sachin ji to say closing remark. Sachin ji, kindly unmute. Just a minute. Main karta hu.
Thank you, Sumit ji. And it was a nice deliberation by Githika ma'am, and so far 5 session has been completed and today is the last day. Aur abhi tak ka jo bhi session hua, mujhe aisa lagta hai ki sare session excellent the aur sabhi audience ne kafi participate kiya isme, aur jitne questions yahan pe discuss hue sare questions ki quality bahut achhi thi aur hum logo ne bahut kuch sikha hai yahan pe as a speaker, as a participant, hum logo ne yahan pe bahut kuch sikha hai. और फिर हमने सारे क्वेश्चंस को अगले सेशन के लिए या अगले सेमिनार और वेबिनार के लिए पार्क भी करके रखा है जहां हम उसको यूज कर सकते हैं. लाइक गाफा टैक्स वाज वेरी न्यू टू मी, तो मैं इसको डेफिनेटली अपने स्लाइड में यूज करूंगा जब भी मैं डेलिब्रेशन दूंगा. और ऑफकोर्स सुमित जी ने काफी प्रोफेशनली इसको मैनेज किया. थैंक्स टू अमित जी जिन्होंने बहुत अच्छे से मॉडरेट किया पूरे सेशन को. एंड अगेन थैंक्स टू गीतिका मैम जिन्होंने हमारे इन्विटेशन एक्सेप्ट किया. और इवन शी वॉज ट्रेवलिंग इन द लास्ट वीक, सो वी पोस्टपोन्ड इट टू दिस वीक. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you, Sachinji.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, Kasa.
And thanks to Sachinji to you for designing this entire course in 5 days.
Thank you.
For wonderful architect of this course, and thanks to each participant. And definitely, I will host this video recording in our YouTube channel for your ready reference in future. So thank you once again, ma'am. Just before closing the session. Githika ma'am, this is for you, certificate of appreciation from my side.
Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot.
And now, thanks to each one of you. Now closing the session. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Thanks, everyone. Wonderful experience. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you.